morning in light of the baptism of Silver Lynn, I wanted to just break away for 1 week and speak to the significance of children in our life. If you want to hear the story of the Elijah story, a really crazy story, come this evening. We're going to talk about that this evening at 6 o'clock. But this morning I'm going to talk to you about a quiver and a rock. We heard the word that in Psalm 127 that children are a blessing from the Lord, and when our quiver is full, we are blessed by God. And we also heard that if we were to cause one of these children, a believer, to stumble, it would be better if we had a millstone tied around our neck and we were thrown into the sea. So there's a quiver and there's a rock. And I'm going to talk about those significant stories in Scripture and how it applies to us with children. In the Garden of Eden, God placed Adam and Eve, and they were created perfect. They were created in the image of God, and God commanded them and blessed them as male and female, as a man and a woman. And he said, "Be fruitful and multiply. Fill the earth and rule it." And so one of the blessings and one of the things that God intended was that when a man and a woman come together in the union of marriage, that children would be something that would come from their marriage. Truly, when a man and woman become one, they have a child, and it's part of both of them, and both of them become one person. And so we celebrate children. In the world today, the number of children per family is dropping. And the American statistics say that the average U.S. family today includes 1.9 children. 60 years ago, it was nearly 2.5 children per family. And so the number of children in our family is dropping. And it's a worldwide trend. Now, there are many reasons for this, one of them being people are getting married at an older age. One of the reasons is there are a plethora of things that we can use for controlling the number of children we have. There is the factor that children cost a lot of money today. And so some parents say it's not affordable. And then there is the mindset of the world of many that children are a burden. Children cramp our lifestyle. They make things impossible for us to do. We lose our freedom. And so we don't want to have children, if any or many. But the scripture passage that we read this morning in Psalm 27 says that children are a heritage, that they are a reward from God, that blessed is a man whose quiver is full of them. Children are heritage. A heritage. A heritage is an inheritance. An inheritance is something that's given to us. It's not something we earned. It's not something we possessed. It's something that was gifted to us. Children are a heritage, a gift from the Lord. Blessed is the man whose quiver is full of them. Now, I'm not here today to say that young couples need to have dozens of children. I don't know what it means when your quiver is full. God does. And God will fill your quiver to the proper number. But it did cause me to pause when I saw in the Pew's research that in the U.S., we have the highest rate of Christian children being raised in single-parent homes. And in so many parts of the world, the Pew research says that non-Christians have larger households than Christian households. That did cause me to pause. Now, I'm not here to talk about how many children we should have and how we should manage our birth control. I'm here to talk this morning today about how children are a blessing. That children are to be considered a gift. The children are a blessing from God, and they are not a burden. The Bible says that they are a blessing. So let's see them as blessings. Let's treat them as blessings. Let's treat them as gifts, as an heritage from the Lord. The burden that we bear in life is not our children. The burden that we bear is sin in our life. And the burden that our children bear is sin in their life because they are born sinful in nature. And they can't do anything about it unless they are told, unless they are taught, unless they hear about the gospel of grace and forgiveness and the love of Jesus, which we have heard, which allows us to lay the burden of sin in our life at the cross so that Jesus can take it away. So children aren't a burden, but sin is. But I'm here to say that children are work, and that they require effort, that they require energy. It says, blessed is the man whose quiver is full of them. Now, a quiver is the thing that holds the arrows that the archer uses when he is out in battle, when he is out protecting the flock. He uses them to shoot the enemy, whether it be a wild animal or whether it be someone who is warring against him. The quiver holds the arrows. And the point of an arrow, the reason we have arrows is that we load them in the bow and we shoot them and we want them to hit the target. Now, if children are like arrows in a quiver, where do we want them to land? Where do we want them to be targeted toward? Where do we aim them at? Well, if they are going to withstand against the enemy, the place that we need to point them and direct them and aim them and shoot them in a sort of way is to Jesus, to our Savior. Now, children are a lot of work. They require a lot of care. They do cost a lot of money, but the joy that they provide far outweighs us all. Now, yes, children are fun. Children are a great joy, and I can tell you that grandchildren are even more fun. And grandchildren are even more joyful in our life as people. But this is only our perspective. This is how we look at kids. We see them as cute. We see them as fun when they're little. And we'd love to watch them grow up and mature and get their feet under them. And they begin to crawl. And then they begin to walk. And then they begin to talk and grow up. We love to watch this happen. But I want us to look at children through the eyes of our God. He gives them as gifts to us. He says, here is a child. He offers them to us as a gift. And selfishly, we want them for our own joy because they do bring joy to our lives. But God gives them to us not only for our joy, but for His joy. Imagine the joy that God experiences when He brings children into the world, like Silver Lynn. Imagine the joy that God experiences when someday Silver Lynn becomes of age and she stands up and says, I believe in Jesus. I love my God because He has saved me, because He has given me life, because He is the one who blesses me in every part of my life. Imagine the joy that gives to God's ears when He hears a child of His stand up and say that in the world. Imagine the joy that heaven experiences when someone stands up and professes their faith in Jesus Christ and proclaims His name as Lord of all. He wants us to teach them this. He wants us to show them who they are, that children are sinners. He wants us to teach them about who Jesus is, the Savior, about who God is, as the one who is holy and wants to love us, about the Holy Spirit, the one who counsels and directs and guides us and blesses us in our life, who dwells in our hearts. Now, Psalm 127 and Matthew 7 tell us that unless the Lord is involved in building our household, we do so in vain. Unless the Lord is involved in the building of his house, the builder labors in vain. Now, how many of you have ever done something, participated in something, and knew that it was going to fail, and continued to go forward in it? Now, I would hope that all of us would say, once we figured out that it was going to be in vain, that it was going to be a failure, we stopped and tried to redirect and find a different way to accomplish the task. Now, if we try to raise our children on our own, in our own strength, in our own power, we are going to fail. And I hear parents, not here, but I hear parents in the world talking about how they tried, how they did their best, how they loved their children. But yet, when they look at their children, when we see their children, we see that they are missing something. They are missing the mark. They have no peace. They have no contentment. They are angry. They are bitter. And they want to do something because life just does not seem worth living. Now, these parents tried hard. Yes, they did. But they did it in their own strength. They tried to do it in their own power, by their own will. The Bible says, unless the house is built in the power of God, the builder labors in vain. And so I want us as parents, us as the church, you as parents of children, to remember this. As parents, this is a moment where you have to walk and live by faith. Where you have to do the things that God asks of you and trust that God's Spirit will do His work, just like He promised this morning in baptism. Now this water in the baptismal font, it isn't, even though Tice blessed it multiple times, it isn't magic water. Okay? It isn't that this is, everything is fine now. Because the Bible in Matthew says that the one who builds his house on the rock and the one who builds his house on the sand, both of them are going to experience storms. The storms are going to come. The rain is going to come. The water is going to rise up. We're all going to have storms in our life. Now, I know as parents, we want to protect our children from any storm and every storm that comes in their life. And we can do so when they're little, most of the time. But as they grow older, we can't be there all the time. As they become adults, we cannot be there and save them from every storm that comes in their way. But the Bible says that if we allow them and teach them how to build their life on the rock when the storms come, their life will not fall apart. When babies pass before they were supposed to be born, 3 in 14 months, I've never experienced that. My heart breaks. My knees want to give away. But when we trust in God, when we've built our house, when we've built our house, our church, our faith on a rock, when we've allowed God to be the builder of our life, we can stand strong in faith. Oh, we're weak. We're weary. We're sad. But we stand in our faith, in our hope, in grace, and God holds us up. He gives us the strength as He promised to do. Now, I want us to know that If we believe in a triune God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, when these storms come in our life, if we really live by faith, if parents, if you really, as you raise your children, as you love them from the time that they have to be in your arms till the time that you have to hold on to them for fear of them running away, till the time that you have to kind of let them go, if you do it by faith, God will bless that. But faith says that we teach them who they are, that they are sinners, that there is a God who loves them, and He is holy. And because He is holy, He has sent Jesus to be a Savior. And we tell them about who Jesus is and how much He loves us. And then how we can follow Him with the help of the Holy Spirit. God says we have this treasure in jars of clay, to show that this all-surpassing power is from God and not from us. We are hard-pressed on every side, but we are not crushed. We are perplexed, but not in despair. We are persecuted, but not abandoned. We are struck down, but we remain alive. This only happens when God helps us. And God only helps us when we learn to trust in Him and when we learn to who He is. And so parents, your greatest responsibility is not simply to teach your daughter how to barrel race. I saw a video of a small girl barrel racing, and I'm thinking, that's going to be Silver Lynn someday. Your main responsibility is not to teach her how to barrel race. Your main responsibility is not how to teach them how to earn lots of money and be successful in life. Those are all important things. We want our children to be successful. We want our children to enjoy things in life, like barrel racing or playing basketball or participating in band, choir, and any other thing that the world offers. We want them to enjoy it, but we want them to be able to enjoy it because they are doing it out of gratitude to God. Yes, you can ride a horse around barrels out of gratitude to God. You can get an exhilarating feeling by crossing that line and having a great time, and you can say, thank you, God, for the beauty of a horse and the joy that I experience in riding it. Thank you for this blessing. You do it to thank God out of gratitude and grace that He has given us. But that has to be taught. That doesn't happen by osmosis. They need to hear it. I will tell you, as parents, they need to hear it from the time they are born. Don't wait until they're teenagers. It's too late. Start when they are young. These are the formational years. Bring them to church when they're little. I don't care if they make noise. I don't care if they cry. God loves to hear His people worshiping. And He loves to hear the noise of little ones in worship. Now you think that there's nothing happening, that they're getting nothing out of it. They are. Because the Spirit is forming them. The Spirit is shaping them. It's God who is building them, not us. And so we have to present them and bring them and share them with God. Now, the other text in Matthew talks about a millstone. And it talks about the children that came to Jesus, and Jesus said, unless you become like a child, you cannot enter the kingdom of heaven. And He's not saying we have to become little toddlers once again. What He's saying is that we have to trust and depend upon our Heavenly Father in the same way that children are totally dependent and trusting of parents. Silver Lynn, I understand, never cries. She's a beautiful, loving, caring baby. But typically, children of Silver's age cry. cry when they want something. And they can't tell us. They can't communicate. And so we ask, wonder, do they need to be changed? Do they need to go to sleep? Do they need a bottle? Do they need to be fed? And we figure it out by process of elimination. They trust that mama and dada are going to take care of them. When they're hungry, they're going to feed them. When they need to sleep, they're going to give them a place to sleep, hopefully in their arms. We have to trust in God for the same things, for all of the things that we need in life. And so he's talking about having that childlike trust. But as a family of God, as a family of believers, we trust in God and we trust in each other to help each other. And so the passage says that if you cause one of these little ones, one of these Christians, one of these children of God, one of these children of our family to stumble, to sin, it would be better if a millstone were tied around your neck. A millstone was used to crush the olives. It was a heavy stone that rolled around in the olive press, and it crushed the olives and squeezed the oil out so the oil would run out of the press. It was a heavy stone. The weight in itself crushed the olives. It would cause anything and everything to sink to the bottom of the sea. He's saying that if God has blessed us with children, if they are a gift from God, a heritage from the Lord, we as Christian parents are responsible to receive them as gifts, to treat them as gifts, to love them as a gift from God, and to train them, to teach them, to disciple them. In the home, it's the parents' responsibility to teach our children about who God is and about the love of Jesus. And if we fail as parents, if we do not do that, if we think that, oh, that's the church's job, or we think that's the Christian school's job, or we think that's the pastor's job, it's someone else's job, we are fooling ourselves. If we do not teach our children about who Jesus is, we have dishonored God and the gift he has given us. Now, I'm not saying that parents are responsible for the sins of the children. No. But if parents have not done their duty, have not tried their with all their might, with all their strength, with God's help to teach children about who they are as sinners and who Jesus is, and these children live their adult life not knowing anything about God or Jesus, the sins that they commit are on the child, but the fact that you did not teach them or try to teach them, that's on you. Now, we know that our children are going to sin. We know that our children are not perfect. We're okay with that. Because if we teach them and build their life on the foundation that there is a Savior, that there is forgiveness through Jesus Christ to those who repent, there is hope. That's the only hope we have. I'm a 60-year-old adult, and I still need that hope. I still sin. I am still not perfect by any sense of the word. And in fact, the older I get, the more I realize my imperfections and my need of grace and my need of a Savior. But thank God I have one. Thank God I had parents who taught me about who this Savior is. And so God gives us a quiver. Children. As we shoot them off into life, where are we aiming them for? My hope is that they hit Jesus right in the center of his heart, and that his heart becomes our heart, their heart. And that they grow up to love the Lord even better than I did because of the Spirit's work in their life. But what's the alternative? A heavy rock, a burden, a loss, an unsaved life that brings tears to our eyes. This morning, I want to emphasize that when Silver Lynn came for baptism, baptism does not save her. The promises that God gave and presented this morning will save her when she believes them. But for the three children that we lost this past 14 months, they never had the chance to grow up, to claim the promise. Those three children, because they did not know, because God knew them when they were born, and they were going to be coming into covenant Christian families, those three children are saved because of God's love for them. And so we trust in God's love. We trust in His promise. And we do the work that God calls us to as parents so that our children can be not only a blessing to us, but that they can be a blessing to God. And when they are a blessing to God, let me tell you, from experience, when my children, three of the four, love the Lord, what a blessing. And I see my six grandchildren living in a home, learning about the love of Jesus, what a blessing. For my one child, for our one son, we hold on to hope. And we pray that the promise that he received at baptism would touch his life. We did everything we could. And now we ask that God would do whatever he can and is able to do. Because unless the house is built by the Lord, our labors are in vain. Let's pray. Father in heaven, you give us children as a gift, as a blessing. And you ask us to raise them, to train them, to love them, to care for them, to provide for them. But you also tell us that unless you are involved in that process, our labors are in vain. And so we pray, Lord, that as your people, as families, as young families, as grandparents, as parents in this church, that we would do all that we can in your power and in your strength to allow our children's lives to be built, not in vain, but that we may allow them and help them to be built on a rock so that when the storms of life come, they will not be swept away. But that they will be held in the grip of your hand, in the power of your love, because they have received your love, because they have heard about your love, because they have believed in your love. And so help us. Help us never to forget that we need your help and that you have promised to help us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.